Father, we thank you, dear God, for today. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to be here together to worship you, dear God, in spirit and in truth. I know, God, that you have a word for your people today. As we start a new series, a challenging series, but one, God, I think is going to open our eyes and our hearts, dear God, change us from the inside out. Lord, I ask you to speak to us today, minister to us today, God, as we exalt you and lift you high. You deserve all the glory and all the honor. And that's what we're here to do today. And I believe that we're going to leave here a changed people, ready to go out and face another week in this world that you've called us to minister. Be with us now, God. Holy Spirit, move in our midst. Minister in and through us as we lift up the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Remain standing. Sing aloud this morning as we worship together.
Oh, beginning of John's Gospel, it says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This next song that we will sing speaks of that Word. When we think of the Word of God, usually we turn to Scripture. That's the Word of God. But the Word of God is also incarnate in Christ. That is the true Word of God, God made manifest in the flesh, is Jesus of Nazareth. So we worship and sing this next song, praying that Christ would speak to us today, that Christ would transform us in this moment. So as we speak of the Word and as we dwell in God's Word, it is all centered on Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So as we sing this song, let's listen for the Word of God, to hear that voice and to hear it speak to us. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak what you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Let me stay and rest in your wholeness. Word of God, speak.
But we're going to end up in Luke's Gospel, chapter 7. Luke chapter 7 is where we're going to find our way to today. We finished up our family church series a couple weeks ago, and I had been praying about where we would go from there. What would be our next step? And God had given me some things, shared some things with me over the last few weeks, put things in my heart. And I believe that He has given me an outline of a series, which I believe is going to be maybe more challenging for me to preach than for you to receive. I don't know. I don't want to judge you on that end, but we're going to, over the next few weeks, here's what we're going to do. We're going to start a sermon series, or be in a sermon series called Counter Culture. Counter Culture. And then over the next, I think it's probably going to be about a 5-week series, and over the next 4 weeks, we're going to talk about specific cultural issues that cause contention in society and even in the church. You could probably think of some of them. We all have our opinions. We all have our own culture and norms and values. But I believe when it comes to certain cultural issues, certain things that are causing division in our world today, the Word of God must speak. Not what thus saith Pastor Ashley, or thus saith you, or any politician, or anybody else that might be an influencer in your life. We have to let the Word of God speak. Right. And I'll just be honest, on some of these issues, I would rather it be thus saith the Lord than what my own opinion is. You will very rarely see me voice openly. I mean, I'd mind in a sermon about certain things, but when it comes to big topics, you don't see me voice my own opinion openly very much. I might privately to you. But I've had certain people, not necessarily in this congregation, but even out in the community, try to get me as a pastor to voice my say on something, and I'm just like, well, here's what the Word of God says. Because I don't want to sink my own ship. And I don't want to get caught up in a conversation that really has no way out. No safe and easy way out. So we're going to start a new series today called Counter Culture. Culture is defined, excuse me, I'm going to take a drink. Culture is defined as, this is from the dictionary, the customary beliefs, social forms, and material traits of a racial, religious, or social group. The set of shared values, attitudes, goals, and practices that characterizes an institution or organization. Can we all agree that that defines culture? Webster did pretty good. We understand what culture is. Culture exists in workplaces. Your workplace has a specific culture. Sometimes that culture is set by the leadership. Sometimes it's set by the subordinates, because there's no good strong leadership. There is culture in families. The Bartlett culture might be different from the Mew culture in some ways. That's okay. There is culture on teams. My son starts baseball this week. His team will have a culture. Me and the other coach were talking this week, and we were like, this is going to be what we value. We want to win games, but we want the kids to have fun doing it and to be developed as kids, as people, as young people, and as athletes. What did we do? We established culture. We even went so far as to tell one coach, potential coach, If you want to help us, you can, but we're not in the business of screaming at kids. So if that's your culture, your ship's going to sail pretty quick. Those are the words we used. Because teams have culture. Community has culture, right? And depending on the community, it's different. Last week I was in Indiana, and I was in Kentucky. The culture up there is different than North Georgia. I hope nobody from Indiana and Kentucky is watching. I'm glad to be back in North Georgia. We have culture in the church. Each church has its own culture. I think we are a culture of people that love and that serve and that grow. Those are our values. Things that we stand for. We are a culture of givers and lovers. No, don't take that the wrong way. We love one another. We love to embrace one another. We're a culture of people who like to touch. Some of us. And hug. Show our affection. We're a culture of helpers. As you'll show me on Wednesday and Thursday night. We have a wonderful culture in our church. But every church has its culture. And then the church as a whole, this capital C church, has a culture, right? What we are defined by. And I would say that the culture of the church has to be what the Word of God speaks.
True.
And if you're wondering, I did ask them to sing that song today. Our groups that we're a part of have established culture. They have norms and values. These groups are defined by that culture. As a matter of fact, the culture sometimes defines the people that are a part of the group. And that's okay. If people look at me and say, well, you know what? You look just like that church looks. Then I've done my job well. And you should say the same. You know what? You fit the mold perfect at Gordon Lake. Oh, well, thank you. That's a compliment because we just laid out what we stand for, who we are. You fit the culture. Our culture in society is rapidly changing, as you can tell, like never before. Much of it is out of our control. And there are many issues in culture that are causing contention that we as the church must not neglect or overlook. It's easy for us to have our own beliefs and our own shared values. But I think we can agree that the beliefs and the shared values of the church and even of this church are not in line with that of the culture of the world. Our culture is different, and our culture should be different. The church is a counterculture to the world. It's different. We are called to be different. So how do we exist in both cultures? You're going to leave here and go be part of the world. So how do you be a part of the culture of the church while being a part of the culture of the world when they're so different? Welcome to the new series. We're going to help you. God's Word is going to help us. I believe that we must face these issues that divide the two cultures. We have to talk about it. We have to deal with it. And rather than just conforming to the mainstream culture, we have to take a stand and follow Jesus' example of touching culture with love and compassion. We have to get out there and touch culture. And I will argue And Jesus' example today will support it, that rather than conforming to the mainstream culture and condemning the mainstream culture and running away from the mainstream culture and just deciding to look the other way and ignore the mainstream culture, I believe that we have a responsibility to reach out to the mainstream culture. We have a responsibility to reach out and touch culture. And many times as the church, we don't want to face that. We don't want to be in opposition. We don't want to see conflict. We don't want to have to address those issues. Because we're called to be separated from the world. We're called to a life of holiness and living holy. And I don't argue that point. Yes, we are. But sometimes in the church, we want to retreat into our building, close the doors and seal them, raise up the drawbridge, and separate ourselves from what is out there around us. A lost and dying world. We just want to hunker down in our own little space and say, well, you know what? We'll let them fight that battle themselves. When it is our responsibility to go out into that world and say, the Word of God says this about the issues that are causing contention in this culture. We have to face these things of contention. There are people in the world around us whose souls are being victimized by the enemy. And they are waiting on the church to rise up and say, thus saith the Lord. Jesus teaches us about healing and changing people's lives. And if you were a part of our Wednesday night chat on this past week, you got a prelude as to where we're going today. Jesus gives us an example of how we are to bring about change in the lives of others. I want to read, this is not my main scripture. We'll get there in a minute. Y'all just stay with me. I want to read out of Mark's Gospel chapter 1 as Jeff puts it up here. Verse 29. As soon, and I read this Wednesday night, so if you were tuning in Wednesday night or you watched later, you've heard this. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon Peter's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever. She was sick. She had a fever. And they immediately told Jesus about her. So Jesus went to her. Listen to what he does. Took her hand. Jesus, don't you know there's COVID out there? And he helped her up. The fever left her and she began to wait on them. God brought about change in her life through the touch of Jesus. Skip down to verse 40, same chapter. A man with leprosy came to Jesus, came to him and begged him on his knees. If you are willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus says to him, I'm willing. Jesus was indignant. He was filled with compassion. He reached out his hand and touched the man. He said, I am willing. Be clean. Immediately the leprosy left him and he was cleansed. In both instances here, Jesus comes in contact with individuals who the culture says you need to stay away from. I mean, the woman's got a fever. She's probably contagious. The man's got leprosy. Clearly he's unclean. Jesus, what are you doing? What are you doing, Jesus? But you see, Jesus is a part of the counterculture. Because the counterculture, or the church of the living God, says, hey, we don't always do things the way the world expects that we should do it. We're going to go against the norm here of society. Because there are people that need to be changed. Jesus does not just defy culture. Jesus does not speak against culture. He doesn't just go on social media and voice his own opinion about what is right and wrong. Oh boy. No. Jesus doesn't just sit back and judge these people. He doesn't just sit back and say, well, you got yourself in this mess, get out of it. Jesus transforms lives. The life of a sick mother-in-law and the life of a leper by compassionately touching them. He goes to them in their sickness, in their uncleanliness. Now, I'm not telling you to go to somebody's house this week that's got corona and lay hands on them and pray they're healed. That's not what I'm going at today. I'm not saying it's a physical touch for the church, but I believe if we're going to see change come about in the lives of the people around us that are needing change and needing cleansing of God's by God's power and His blood, then we have to spiritually have a compassionate touch in their life. We have to care. Over the course of these next few weeks, we're going to address these issues that divide church, the church culture, and the world's culture. But before we get there, I believe we have to understand that there's a better way to approach contention than the way some of us might be doing it. And I believe Jesus, we have to go to God's Word to see what the better way is. You will notice that, and I kind of just hit on this, but if you follow me on social media, or if you know very much about me at all, most of you do, I don't speak out a lot against or for certain things. And it's not that I don't feel a responsibility. I just think we have to be very, very careful about how we approach issues that bring about contention in our culture. And over the next few weeks, as God strengthens me and leads me, I'm going to preach against some of those things that our culture thinks are acceptable. And I'm probably not going to make any friends. But I wasn't called by Almighty God to preach His Word to make friends. I was called to see lives changed by the power of God's Word and the anointing of His Holy Spirit. And if you or anybody watching or anybody that does watch is offended, well, the Word of God speaks. Luke's Gospel, chapter 7. Told you we'd get there. Luke's Gospel, chapter 7, verse 36. Jesus is going to show us a better way. How do we bridge the gap between the culture of our world and the culture of the church? We have to cover this today before we can jump into the next 4 weeks. Trust me, we have to. We have to. Jesus shows us a better way in Luke's Gospel. Verse 36. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, here we are, we got this religious leader, super intelligent, probably knows the Old Testament by heart, yet can't recognize the Messiah. When one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. A woman in that town who lived a sinful life learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. As she stood behind him at his feet, weeping. So Jesus is probably kneeling here, kind of, because she's behind him, but she's at his feet. As she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner. Verse 40, Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. Tell me, teacher, he said. Listen to the story Jesus gives here. Two people owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he forgave the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon answered, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt forgiven. That'd be my answer. The guy who owed him more probably is the one who is indebted the most, is the one who will love him the most. Jesus says, you have judged correctly. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume, expensive perfume, on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, as her great love has shown. But whoever has been forgiven little loves little. Then Jesus said to her, your sins are forgiven. This lady has just asked for forgiveness through her tears, her signs of love, of honor, of pouring her expensive perfume on Jesus. Verse 49, the other guests began to say among themselves, who is this who even forgives sins? Jesus said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go and in peace. May God add his blessing to his word. Well, now that I've read my main text, we can get started with the message. I'm kidding. We're going to land the plane real quick right here. Because the word of God speaks.
Yes.
Brother Jack, this story gives us a model, an approach, an example of how we are to approach the culture of the world, of how we bridge the gap between the culture of the church and the culture of society. Jesus, right here in Luke's gospel, has showed us a better way to approach contention, a better way to extend a compassionate touch to the world. Jesus has given us an example here. And it's an odd one. If you're in this home, if you're in this Pharisee's home and you see this happen, you're in shock. I mean, I can't imagine the tone in this home when this happens. I heard a preacher one time way back, he compared, I heard him preach about this. He said, I want you to think of your pastor. You invite your pastor to your home for dinner. And he's sitting at your table ready to dine. And a random prostitute in town that everybody knows is unclean and sinful and dirty in all her ways walks in and all of a sudden starts massaging your pastor's shoulders. I'd probably just close my eyes and enjoy it. I'm kidding. But what would be the look on your face like? What is he doing? We know who she is. We know her lifestyle. What do you think these people were thinking in the home of the Pharisee when Jesus didn't stop the lady? No, he allowed her to finish. To cry on his feet, to dry his feet with her hair, to pour out perfume on his feet. Regardless of the issues, the standards, the norms, the values that divide us, regardless of the fact that the church is a counterculture to the world, as it should be, we must understand that there are two types of people. The holy and the unholy. Despite all the issues that divide us, despite our opinions on things, and despite what thus saith the Word of God, people are either holy or they're unholy. And this is the example that Jesus gives us in Luke's Gospel. If we're going to touch the world with compassion, and if we're going to lead those that are unholy to the cross and to the feet of Jesus, we must understand how to approach contention. We must understand how to approach these cultural issues that divide us. And the first step that we must take before we can talk about any of these issues that divide the church from the world is that we are a part of the unholy group. Well, Pastor, that goes against everything that you teach us. Listen, we are called to live a life of holiness, set apart from the ways of wickedness that we were once in. But at the end of the day, this is amazing grace. And it's only by that amazing grace that any of us were saved in the first place. And in the eyes of the bigger picture, we are all unholy. Saved by grace by the only one who is holy. And his name is Jesus. And it is our goal to strive to be like him in all of his holiness. How do we lower the drawbridge between the church and the world? How do we open the doors for conversation, for moments to address issues, to say what thus saith the Word of God? How do we prepare ourselves for the next 4 weeks to talk about specific cultural issues that bring about contention? By first realizing that we are just as unholy as everybody else. Saved by grace, covered by the blood, and on a path to be holy like Christ is holy. And when we realize that, Tina, when we realize how broken we are as people, how deep down God had to reach in the miry clay to pull me and you out of the sin and the lifestyle we were in, to make us Christians at the foot of his cross. When we realize that, we can't but help to have a compassionate and loving touch. Sister Donna, when I think about people who are struggling in the world and they're confused and their souls are victims to the enemy who is tricking them into believing that certain things are okay and that God is too loving to send you to hell for that, I can only stop and think, you know what? I was tricked too, but God's grace through Jesus Christ, His Son, saved me and has set me apart now. And I believe that through a compassionate and loving touch of the church, a culture that believes in doing and loving and serving and growing, then we can make a difference. And we can lower the drawbridge, and we can invite people in and see them walk towards that same cross that He led us to. In a loving way. You're never going to get somebody to change directions in what they believe by condemning them and throwing judgment at them. Read Luke 7. Jesus showed love to this woman, and it was countercultural to what they expected out of Him. If only He was a prophet, He would know that she was a sinner. And I can see Jesus' mind turning like, if only you had been saved by grace, you would know that she's got a chance. And this world can be changed because of it. Because of that grace and love. Hey, the next few weeks, I'm going to call wrong, wrong, and I'm going to call right, right as God leads me. But we're going to do it with love and with compassion. Not to point fingers and say, that's not right. But to say, you know what? I can show you what is. I can lead you to a man who wants to save you and change you from the inside out. And wants to dine with you and welcomes you at his table. I don't agree with what's going on in our world. I don't agree with it, Renee. It's not right. I'm not going to give the enemy any credit. But Jesus gives us a better way to approach it. And speaking for myself is not the way. We have to let the Word of God speak. Because that is the only word that's going to change lives. I read something this week as you stand. A pastor friend of mine put something on social media. And it was a challenge to pastors that we don't have to be so fancy in our delivery. We don't have to worry about, you know, saying the right thing. All we need to worry about is speaking the Word of God as He gives it to us. And he said, you don't believe that? Jonah witnessed an entire community of people in Nineveh give their hearts to the Lord and change their lifestyles with an 8-word sermon. Why? Because Jonah let the Word of God speak. I'm just going to tell you, folks, the world doesn't care what you've got to say to them. They don't want to hear it. You can get in somebody's face and argue till you're red in the face, and they don't want to hear what you've got to say. But when you allow Jesus to speak through you, as Philip said, speak to you and then speak through you, you can be an agent of change in a world that certainly needs it. And you can look at those people and be like, you know what? I was unholy just like you. But because of Jesus, I'm on a path to living a life of holiness. Cleanliness, a life changed in Him. Amen? That is the way. That is the way. That is how we handle contention in our culture. That's it. Thus saith God's word. Amen? Pastor Philip's going to lead us in a song. One that we've tried to sing for 3 weeks. And it's just not worked out. It's going to work today. Because I hope and I believe that God's changed your life with a compassionate touch. He did me. And because of that, I exalt Him. I exalt Him. And when I exalt Him, it reminds me of the unholiness that I was once in. And the life of holiness that He's taking me to. Each and every step of the way. I want you to think about that as we sing this morning. I exalt Thee. Sing it aloud.
For Thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods. For Thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth. Thou art exalted far above all gods. I exalt Thee.
Yes, amen.
I exalt Thee. I exalt Thee.
You are our God. You are our Redeemer. You are the one who gives us examples to live by as You speak in Your Word. For that we are thankful. Thank You for Your Word today. Thank You for Your presence, Holy Spirit of God, in our lives. May we take this Word, hide it in our hearts, God, and carry it forth as we approach issues and people in our culture, in our society. May we lower the drawbridge. May we bridge the gap, and may we do it with a compassionate and loving touch. Showing them the way to the cross, and the way to a life set apart from the world that is holiness in You, Jesus. Lord, I ask You to be with us this week, dear God, as we go from this place. Meet the needs of Your people, dear God. We have so many needs, dear Father. Sister Bobby is in the hospital recovering from an illness, and Sharon is at home recovering from surgery. The Holbrook and Cochran families are mourning the loss of a loved one. My brother, who told me this morning of his uncle who fell off a ladder and is in serious need of healing. And so many other needs in our church, dear God, and in our family and our community. Lord, we ask, dear God, that You would meet the needs according to Your will, God. Let Your power be made known, God, in the answering of these requests, dear Lord. And may You receive all the glory and honor for it, dear God. We ask these things now, as You've told us that we can. Be with us, dear God, as we go from this place. Help us, God, to go compassionately touch a world that needs You, God. Sharing light in the darkness, dear God, and being Your hands and feet to the culture around us. Help us to be countercultural, but to touch the cultures that differ from us with compassion and love. To see lives change and to see people added to your kingdom. We love you so much today. We honor you now. We ask you to bless, God, the gifts that are given. Thank you so much for those who continue to faithfully worship you through giving, dear Father, with their tithe and their offering, mailing it in, dropping it off, dear God, bringing it by, and doing it even online, some of them. We thank you, God, that the faithfulness of your people is representative of the faithfulness of you to us. And for that, we say thank you. Because of that, we are able to do good and bless others. We thank you now. Be with us as we go from here. May you be glorified in all things that we do this week. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said,
amen.
Amen. Listen, I love you, but Jesus loves you so much more. I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful week. And don't forget to all the announcements, the Operation Christmas Child. And if you can help us out this week, we would love to have you Wednesday night and Thursday night. Have a wonderful week. God bless you all.